So, I am going to continue the course which was started by Francesco Pappalardi on finite fields. For the two first courses, I will use the notes which are on the website. So if you find some misprints or some comments on these notes, please tell me. In fact, I revise these notes on a regular basis, and the version which is on my website, which you can access, it has been updated just 2 days ago. So for the first course, I will use these notes and speak on cyclotomic polynomials. For the second course tomorrow, I will continue by speaking to the application to error correcting codes. And the third session is a tutorial session. So we will see at that time what we do. And maybe for the last course, which is on Thursday, I plan to speak on linear recurrent sequences. This is an important chapter in the book of Liddell and Niederreiter related to finite fields. But it's something which is interesting also in the case of characteristic zero. And I understand that the course is supposed to be finite fields and number theory, so there are some applications to number theory. But mainly it is, I will speak on finite fields. So today I speak on the cyclotomic polynomials, and these polynomials are related with the roots of unity, and the roots of unity give cyclic groups. So we have to use several facts on cyclic groups. In particular, when we have an element which satisfies an element x which satisfies x to the n equal 1, you have to remember that it does not mean that x has order n. It means only that x has an order which divides n. So the order of an element is the smallest n such that x power n is equal to 1. My goal is to explain mainly the cyclotomic polynomials of finite fields. But we can start with the complex numbers. And so we look at the roots of unity in the complex numbers. Maybe I should insist on the fact that when you have a finite field, K, when you take the non-zero element of K, then you have a multiplicative group. If K has order Q, has a Q element, then this is a multiplicative group of order Q minus 1. And therefore, any element in K cross satisfies x to the Q minus 1 equal x, equal 1. This is something that you have seen just in the lecture before by Peter. And so we have roots of unity. When we deal with finite fields, we deal only with roots of unity. So we are interested in the question, when we have an element, when it satisfies zeta to the n equal 1, we want to study the irreducible polynomial over some field. You know, in fact, that K is the set of elements which satisfies x to the q equal x. K is a finite field with characteristic p. Q is the power of p. X to the q equal x has no multiple roots. And in algebraic closure, it has q roots. And the q roots are exactly the elements of K. This was repeated again this morning. And so we are interested in the element zeta, which satisfies zeta to the n equal 1. So I can erase that, it's okay. And I start by looking at the complex numbers. So I fix an integer n greater than or equal to 1. The case 1 is trivial, but okay, so let me say greater than or equal to 2. And then we look, yeah?
Could you try another black pen because it is not very visible in the deck?
What should I do to write?
Get another pen.
Another pen, okay, thank you.
Yeah. This one. Yeah. Yeah.
Ah, okay.
You see the difference.
Yes. Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. So I take an integer n greater than or equal to 2. And I look at the nth root of unity. We will speak on cyclotomy. And cyclotomy means to divide the circle. Cyclo is for the circle from the Greek, and tomy is the root. Root means to divide, to cut. And so we want to divide the circle into n equal parts in such a way that we have a regular polygon with n edges. So this is the point 1, this is I, this is minus 1, and this is minus I. So if you want to divide in two parts, you have just 1 and minus 1. In four parts, you have I and minus I. If you want one more part, you have j and j square, so which should be about here, and so on. So the point that you have on the circle are the points which are exponential 2i pi k over n, where k goes from 0 to the n minus 1. So this is in the complex plane. And it does not really make sense to speak of such numbers in the finite field. So you have to be careful when you deal with numbers to know whether you do not have some maps, some algebraic maps between the finite fields and the complex numbers. So you have to be careful when you go from one to the other. But we will do this, but of course very carefully. So these are the roots of the polynomial xn minus 1. So it's the product from k equals 0 up to n minus 1 of x minus exponential 2i pi k over n. These roots give a cyclic group, mu n, which is the set of exponential 2i pi k over n, 0 less than k, less than n minus 1. And this is a cyclic subgroup of c star. It is generated, for example, by exponential 2i pi over n. So exponential 2i pi over n is one generator. But this is not the only is a generator. So let me call it zeta. But there are some other choices for the generator. And the other choices are the zeta to the k, where k is as a GCD between k and n, which is equal to 1. So the number of choices for such a k, we can take k between 0 and phi minus 1, and n minus 1. The number of such generator is phi of n. And now for each d which divides n, you have a unique subgroup of mu n, because mu n is cyclic, so there is this was repeated again this morning. You have a unique subgroup of order d, and this is the elements which satisfy zeta to the d equal 1. So like this, you have a partition of the set of unities by looking at the order of the roots of unities. And so this will give a decomposition of the polynomial xn minus 1. And to get this decomposition, we define phi n of x as the product for 1 less than for 0 less than k. No, so for 1 less than k less than n, well, we can take 0 and minus 1. But to take the GCD of k and n, which is equal to 1. So let me write exponential to I pi k over n. So this is a polynomial which vanishes exactly at the phi of n generators of the cyclic group. So this is a polynomial of degree phi of n. And now the partition of the set of roots of unity by looking at the order of each root of unity gives you a decomposition of x to the n minus 1, which is the product for d dividing n of phi d of x. So starting from the definition which is here, we deduce this formula. But this formula is very interesting because it gives a definition of the cyclotomic polynomials by induction. So an equivalent definition of the polynomial is to say that this polynomial phi d of x are the polynomials with complex coefficients, which are defined inductively by this condition with the following starting values. If you look at phi 1 of x, it is x minus 1. And then if you want to know what is phi 2, you write x squared minus 1 equal x minus 1 x plus 1. And so here you have phi 1. And because of the formula which is here, phi 2 has to be x plus 1. And so you have phi 2 of x equal x plus 1. Next, you can do the same for any value of n which is a prime number. If you look at xp minus 1, you have x minus 1 times xp minus 1 plus x plus 1. So this is phi 1 of x, but p has only two divisors, which are 1 and p, and so the other one has to be phi p of x. So like this, you have all the phi n for n equal p, and it's not difficult to deduce them by induction and for all values of n. And this is, in fact, the most convenient way of writing the polynomial phi n for the small values of n. So you can do it for n equal, say, less than 16. It's an exercise to write them down, and you find all the formulae. This formula. So if you write these polynomials for the small values of n, if you go up to 100, you will notice that all the coefficients are 1 or minus 1 or 0. And so when you have something which is true for all the values up to 100, it is tempting to guess that it will be true for all values of n. And the answer is that it is not true. What is true is that if the number n has at most two odd prime divisors, has at most two odd prime divisors, then the coefficients of phi n are 0, 1, and minus 1. And so if you want to find a polynomial phi n which has one coefficient which is not 0, 1, or minus 1, you have to take a number which has at least three odd prime divisors. And what is the smallest number which has three odd prime divisors? Which one is it? I'm not here. Three odd prime divisors. So you take 3 times 7, times 5 times 7. So which is 105. And so you find you can write down what is this polynomial. the degree of this polynomial is phi of 105, so it's 2 times 4 times 6. So it's some number which is not that small, but you can compute the coefficients. And you will see that there are two coefficients which are minus 2. So not all coefficients are 1 or minus 1. There are many properties that we can deduce rather easily from the definition from one or the other of the two definitions. In particular, we can deduce what is phi 2n of x in terms of phi n of x. And we find that it is phi n of minus x or phi n of x squared, depending on whether n is odd or even. So we, when we look at phi of 2n, it is either phi of n or 2 phi of n, depending on whether n is even or odd. So if I suppose this is when n is odd and this is when n is even, or the opposite, so depending on whether n is odd or even. Let me write it precisely. N is odd, yes, this is the first case. Another formula which is very useful is to compute phi n of x by involving only the prime divisors. So we define R as the radical of n, which is the product of the prime divisors of n. So it's phi R of x to the power n over R. And what is R? If n is equal to P1A1 PSAS, then R is P1 PS. So again, this is a formula which is not difficult to check by looking at the definitions and looking at the roots of unity and to see what are the groups of roots of unity. From the definition which is the second definition which is here, we deduce inductively that the polynomial phi n has coefficients in Z. Maybe we can first start by saying that the polynomial phi n is monic, which means that the leading coefficient is 1. This comes from the previous definition. And also phi n of minus x is phi n of x for n greater than or equal to 2. So this is a so-called reciprocal polynomial. No, it's not that what I want to say. A reciprocal polynomial, it means that x to the power phi n of 1 over x is phi n of x. So if you look at this polynomial here, you can read it in the other way. You divide by x to the p minus 1, and you divide by x to the p minus 1, and you replace x by 1 over x. So from the formula which we have by induction, we deduce that the polynomials phi n have coefficients in Z. So this is a very important step. We started with polynomials with coefficients in C. The first definition I gave used the exponential 2 I pi over n, which does not make sense in a field which is different from C in general, in particular with a finite field. But now, because these polynomials have coefficients in Z, we can look at them for any field. So if we take any field, K, we have a map from Z to K, which is a homomorphism of algebra or rings, if you prefer. And this is the map which maps one to one. Well, it's not a one to one map. It is the map which the image of one is one. And the kernel gives the characteristic of K. So the kernel is the ideal or the subgroup of Z, which is generated by the characteristic of K. Where C is the characteristic of K. And because we have this ideal, which is a kernel, we have an injective map from Z over CZ into K. This is true, in fact, for any ring K. But if K is a field, then the sub-rings of K have no zero divisors, and therefore C is a prime number. So if K is a field, C is either zero or a prime number. So if we start with this map from Z to K, we can extend this map from Z of X to K of X. It just means that we consider the coefficients of the polynomial as elements of K by using the map which is here. And thanks to that, we can consider the polynomial phi n of X into any field K. So if K is a field, even a ring, then phi n of X is defined as a polynomial with coefficients in this field or in this ring. So from now on, we start with a field K. And we consider phi n of X as a polynomial with coefficients in K. And we ask, what are the roots of phi n in K? So if you take an element, I will call it zeta, the root of phi n in K, because of the definition of phi n, we have xn minus 1, which is phi n of x times the product for d dividing n and d less than n of phi d of x. What I want to point out is that phi n of x divides xn minus 1. If zeta is a root of phi n, then zeta is a root of xn minus 1. So zeta satisfies zeta n equal 1. Now I would like to say that zeta will not be a root of phi d of x, but this is not true in general. We need some assumption on the characteristic of the field. And so the assumption will be that the characteristic of the field does not divide n. So let me look at the special case. Assume that the number n is a multiple of p, and I will denote it by p to the rm, where p is the characteristic of k. Then when I look at this polynomial xn minus 1, it is x to the p to the rm minus 1. But because the characteristic is p, this is the same as x to the m minus 1 to the power p to the r. And so this is the power of a polynomial xn minus 1 if r is greater than or equal to 1. And so for there are several, there are multiple roots. And we can deduce formulae for the phi n of x, which I don't want to discuss. So because of that, you see that there is, we will assume from now on, we assume that the characteristic p does not divide n. where we look with 2φn. In this case, if p does not divide n, then the polynomial xn minus 1 has no multiple root. Because the derivative is n xn minus 1, so the derivative is n xn minus 1, and n is not 0 because p does not divide n. And the roots of xn minus 1 are 0, and 0 is not a root of this polynomial. So there is no multiple root. So let us come back now to this case. We have zeta, which is a root of phi n of x. Therefore, zeta is a root of xn minus 1 because of this formula. But there are no multiple roots. So there is a simple root here, which is zeta. Zeta is a root of this polynomial, so it is not a root of phi d of x. So let me repeat what I just explained. Assuming that p does not divide n, if zeta is a root of phi n, I do not repeat, but from now on, p does not divide n. So if zeta is a root of phi n, then zeta n is equal to 1. This is what was written here. And zeta is not a root of phi d. For d dividing n and d different from n. So because of that, we deduce that zeta d is not equal to 1 for d dividing n and d different from n. It's the same argument. If it was a root of xd minus 1, you decompose xd minus 1 into product of polynomials, and these indices are divisors of d, and therefore they are divisors of n, and zeta is not a root of these polynomials. So if you remember the definition of the order of an element, which I started with, this means that zeta has order n. In the multiplicative group, k star. So we get the conclusion that the roots of phi n of x are elements of k which have order n. And the converse is true. Conversely, if zeta as order n, this means that zeta n equal 1, and zeta d is different from 1 for d dividing n, d different from n. So from the first condition, we deduce that zeta is a root of xn minus 1, so a root of this product. For the second, we deduce that it is not a root of this product here, so it is a root of phi n. So the roots of the polynomial, cyclotomic polynomial phi n in the field k are just the elements of order n, which are the so-called primitive roots of order n. A primitive root of order n is an element which has exactly order n. So the roots of phi n in k are the primitive roots of unity in k. infinity star of order n. So this is in general for a field k, always with the condition that the characteristic does not defy the number n. But now let us look at the special case k equals fq. And we want to investigate this polynomial phi n. I need not tell you, but when we work with z of x, the polynomial phi n is irreducible. There are several proofs of this result. Usually, when you have such a statement, there are not a single proof, but several proofs. And usually, most of the proofs involve the finite characteristic. They work with FP. I included one in the notes, but I will not use this result, so I do not mention it. But over FQ, it's quite different. And it happens that phi n is irreducible, but this is very rare. Most often, there is a decomposition. And we would like to know the decomposition, and for that, we have to know what are the primitive roots of unity in FQ star of order n, where, of course, Q and N have a GCD which is 1. So let us start with the primitive root of unity, zeta. Primitive nth root of unity. We would like to know what is the irreducible polynomial of zeta. So it means that zeta is a root of xn, and it is not a root of the phi d, which are there. If we want to know what is the irreducible polynomial, we know it by the theory which was developed last week by Francesco. The conjugate of fq, that means the other roots of the irreducible polynomial. How do we obtain them? What is the tool to obtain them? There is just one word to say. How do we get the other roots of an element of a field of FQ? What is the name? There is one name to say. What are the roots? Other roots of the conjugate of zeta. Yes, yes. It's obtained by the Frobenius, and so the conjugates. Oh, okay, it's written here. The conjugates are, of course, zeta is the conjugate, zeta q square, and so on, and we go up to zeta to the q to the, let me say, L minus one. So you have to be careful where is the exponent. The exponent is q. And then in the exponent, you have L minus 1. And what is this L? It is, so we would continue, and then the next one would be zeta to the q to the L. But we stop because this is the L is the smallest one, so that zeta to the q to the L is equal to zeta. So it's a cyclic again. And so L is the least integer, so that zeta to the q to the L minus 1 is equal to 1. Maybe I should change this. N is the least integer. So that zeta to the q to the L minus 1 is equal to 1. You see, zeta to the q to the L equals zeta, I write it zeta to the q to the L minus 1. But the minus 1 now is below. It's on the exponent, but not on the second floor. This was on the second floor, and this is on the first floor. So what does it mean that L is the smallest integer so that we have this? Zeta is a primitive nth root of unity, so zeta has order n, and to say that zeta to some power is equal to 1 is equivalent to say that n divides q to the l minus 1.
this is equivalent to say that n divides q to the n minus 1. Or this is equivalent to say that q to the n is congruent to 1 modulo n. So n is the least integer such that q to the n is 1 modulo l. And, but this has a name also. We look at z over nz star. This is a multiplicative group, and q is in this group because n and q are relatively prime. And we look at the smallest integers so that q to the l is the unit element. And so this l is the order of, this is not good. Maybe in blue. So this L is the order of Q. In Z over NZ star. But L is also the number of conjugates which are here. So L is the degree of zeta. So we come to the following conclusion. The polynomial phi n splits in fq of x. Into a product of irreducible polynomials. This is something which is always true. Into a product of irreducible polynomials over FQ. And all of them have the same degree. All of the same degree. And what is this degree? It is the order of Q modulo n. Which means the order of the image of Q in the group Z over nz star. This is a very nice result which follows from what you have seen last week. And it has a lot of consequences. You can ask when this polynomial splits completely into linear factors. It splits completely into linear factors. If and only if the order, the degrees of the irreducible factors is 1, which means that the order of Q modulo n is equal to 1, which means that Q is congruent to 1 modulo n. This is not new. This is the same as to say that n divides Q minus 1. Q minus 1 is the order of FQ star. And it's a cyclic group. And we know that in a cyclic group, we have a subgroup of order n if and only if n divides the order of the group. So this is something that we already knew. But we can deduce other consequences which are not so obvious. For example, we can ask when this polynomial is irreducible. Phi n irreducible in FQ of x. I told you that phi n is irreducible in z of x, but in fq of x is quite different because we need that the order of q modulo n is equal to the, we need that there is only one factor, which means that the order of q modulo n is equal to z over nz star. So the order of q is phi of n. So the class of Q should be a generator of the cyclic group Z over nz star. But in general, Z over nz star is not a cyclic group. So this is true, it is a cyclic group only in very special cases, if n is either a power of a prime or twice a power of a prime. So this can happen only if n is a p to the r or 2p to the r. In such a way that the group, well, maybe I should write L to the R or 2L to the R, where L a prime. And this prime will not be the characteristic because P, the characteristic does not divide N. So it's another prime. And not only this group should be cyclic, but the class of Q should be a generator of this group. So we have some information on the decomposition of the polynomial xn minus 1, but I would like to, the polynomial phi n of x, I would like to go a little bit further. So let me consider the decomposition of phi n of x. To get this decomposition, what we start with is to take one factor, and to take one factor means that we select one primitive nth root of unity. So let me choose zeta, a primitive nth root of unity in some extension of FQ. In FQ bar, say. So the irreducible polynomial of zeta over FQ, as we have seen already, is the product for I equal, okay, so it's the product of x minus zeta to the Q to the I, and we take I from 0 up to n minus 1. Because zeta is, not n minus 1, d minus 1, where d is the degree of zeta. D is the degree FQ of zeta over FQ. And D is the order of Q modulo n. So this is the irreducible polynomial of zeta over FQ. I will write this polynomial as follows. I will look at the powers of Q to the I as the exponents. The exponent starts with 1. Q, Q square, and Q to the d minus 1. What is this subset of FQ of Z over nz star? This is the subgroup which is generated by Q. And the order of this subgroup is d. So we can write this polynomial as the product for say H in capital H of X minus zeta to the H, where H is this subgroup. There is some abuse of notation here, which is that I write zeta to the H, H is Q to the I, but in fact it is the class of Q to the I modulo n. But the exponent depends only on the class, it does not depend on Q to the I itself. So this is the polynomial, irreducible polynomial zeta, and I will denote it by pH of x. It depends on zeta, but I fix some zeta. So pH of x is the irreducible polynomial of zeta over FQ, And pH of x is, of course, a divisor of phi n of x, because zeta is a primitive nth root of unity. Now, what are the other primitive nth root of unity? The other primitive nth root of unity are the zeta nth root of unity. They are the zeta to the, say, m, where the GCD of m and n is equal to 1. We have phi of n of them. What is the irreducible polynomial of zeta m? The irreducible polynomial, it is the product for I equals 0 up to d minus 1. It is the same degree. This is what we have seen before. And then we have x minus zeta m q to the I. The conjugate of zeta to the m are the zeta m to the power q to the I. But we can write this as the product for h in this subgroup h of x minus zeta mh, with the same kind of notation at there. So if we look at the notation pH, we can denote that as p mh, because this corresponds to the class of the class mh of z over nz star by h. And now we have the conclusion, phi n of x, it can be decomposed into a product, and this is the decomposition of phi n of x over fq of x. Phi n of x is the product for all the classes mh, which are the classes modulo h. So it's a class, so we can say that it belongs to z over nz star divided by h, of x of p and h of x. So this is the decomposition of phi n of x into irreducible factors of fq. We have a complete description. I think I have just 2 minutes left, so I will tell you what I will start to explain tomorrow. What I would like to do after that is to decompose the polynomial xn minus 1 over fq of x. To a certain extent, we solve the problem because we decompose phi n, and so we have a decomposition of phi d, and we just put together the decomposition of phi d, and then we get the answer to the decomposition of phi of xn minus 1. But I would like to give another type of decomposition, which is the following. We want to know what are the factors of this polynomial in the splitting field. And we can say what are the factors. The factors, they are the product of x minus zeta to the I. So if zeta is a primitive nth root of unity, as before. And the factors are obtained by taking for I a subset of 1 to n, or 0 to n minus 1. So we take a subset of 0 n minus 1, and we get one factor. So there are 2 to the n factors in the splitting field. Now the question will be, which ones among these factors belong to fq of x? And there is a result that you have seen, which is that when you have a polynomial with coefficients in an algebraic closure of fq, then this polynomial f belongs to fq of x if and only if f of x to the q is equal to f of x power q. This comes again from the fact that FQ of X is the set of elements so that alpha to the Q is equal to alpha, and you look at the coefficients and you get that. And so we have to see among the subset of 0 n minus 1, which one are stable by the multiplication by Q. And so this is what I will do tomorrow. And this decomposition, I will use it for error correcting codes. Okay, thank you.